1941. The Germans occupy half of Russia. Hitler is on the verge of capturing Moscow. The Wehrmacht's armored tanks move ahead relentlessly. Moscow. November 7th, 1941. The 24th anniversary of the communists' rise to power. 28,000 soldiers are gathered in front of the Kremlin in the freezing cold. The Soviet leaders have decided that the traditional parade will still take place. This is a direct order from their supreme leader, Stalin, even though the apocalypse is near. Margarita Pogrebetskaya, a young Muscovite girl, declares, "Moscow, my motherland, my love, invincible Moscow. And November 7th is the loveliest day on the calendar. Red, my favorite color, the color of the revolution, the color of the blood shed in its name." From the top of the Lenin Mausoleum, Stalin speaks out. Stalin invokes the glory of Tsarism to mobilize his troops. And he reminds them, in comparing Hitler to Napoleon, one should not forget Napoleon's fate. Hitler cannot imagine such a fate. The Blitzkrieg or Lightning War that should have put Stalin out of commission in just a few weeks has slowed down. But Nazi Germany still has considerable strength. One last effort, and Moscow will be conquered. Hitler proclaims, "Soldiers of the Eastern Front, the decisive battle begins today. We are about to avert the most terrible threat since the Huns and the Mongols." Moscow holds its breath. Stalin refuses to leave the city. He requisitions part of the population to dig anti-tank trenches. Arrests are multiplied, often targeting Soviets of German origin or the Spartak Moscow's star football player, suspected of having said, "The Germans will take the city. It's the end of Bolshevism." Albina Gantimirova reports, "We collected money for the army. Women came to donate their wedding bands. In Berlin, the German women donate their fur coats." A relentless enemy descends upon the soldiers on the Moscow front. The cold, exceptional temperatures, hitting minus 35 degrees Celsius, crack the tank's steel, harden the tires, freeze the weapons' lubricants, and kill the horses. December 5th, 1941. Stalin and General Zhukov, with his high command, the Stavka, secretly organize a powerful counteroffensive to liberate Moscow. 1 million Soviet soldiers begin to march. Albina Gantimirova, now a senior sergeant, recounts. "Order 227 says not one step back. If you take that step, you'll be executed. Policemen walk behind us and shoot whoever steps backwards. Stalin jokes with his macabre sense of humor. In our army, it's more dangerous to move backwards than forwards. Stretcher bearer Nadezhda Anisimova tells, "Dying, I'm not afraid of dying, probably because I'm young. Death is always close by. Whenever I see a fallen soldier, the others yell out to me, 'Don't go, you'll get yourself killed.' I crawl over to the person, but I bring him back alive. The commander wants to punish me for disobeying, but his second in command wants to decorate me. At 19, I have a medal for bravery and gray hair. I am sent home. I have 2 perforated lungs and a bullet in the spinal cord. I am paralyzed. My mother and sister tell me they had received notification of my death. On the front, other women suffer, yet they continue to fight. The Battle of Moscow is in full swing when suddenly, Stalin receives an important piece of news. On December 7th, 1941, Pearl Harbor, the American naval base in the Pacific, is attacked by Japan, Germany's ally. Franklin Roosevelt, President of the United States, announces that his country is entering the war.
The American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute
victory. Stalin has a new ally. Christmas 1941. Moscow is saved, but the cost is high. 300,000 dead. Stalin broadcasts this image of a woman genuflecting to show that God is no longer outlawed. To the Soviets, Stalin has succeeded in pushing Hitler back 200 kilometers. But the Führer doesn't feel defeated. The Germans are blocked by the Red Army in the north and center of the Soviet Union, but Hitler is preparing a new offensive on the southern front for springtime of the following year. The target of this offensive is Baku's oil. June 28, 1942, the Germans advance at an alarming speed, 300 kilometers in just 1 month. This is Russia's Black Summer. July 23, 1942. Hitler worries his high command with a new project, one that will divide German forces. Hitler orders General Paulus, who organized the attack on the Soviet Union, to move on Stalingrad. This objective is both strategic and symbolic. The city bears Stalin's name. The Germans can then hit Moscow from behind. German tanks move dangerously close to Stalingrad. Stalin receives some reassurance. On August 10, 1942, Winston Churchill, the British Prime Minister, lands in Moscow aboard his personal plane. His traveling companion is an American special envoy, Averell Harriman, the powerful businessman who coordinates Allied aid. This aid will prove decisive. 15,000 planes, 140,000 trucks, millions of tons of fuel and supplies. Molotov, Stalin's Minister of Foreign Affairs, greets the two men with the International, the Soviet anthem of the time. The two representatives of the capitalist world listen to the revolutionary chant without the slightest reaction. Churchill states, "If Hitler invaded hell, I would side with the devil." Churchill writes in his memoirs, I pondered on my mission to the sullen, sinister Bolshevik state that I had once so hard tried to strangle at its birth, which I had regarded as the mortal foe to civilized freedom. A magnificent Packard limousine drives them to the Kremlin, where Stalin awaits them. Everyone is all smiles. The Americans and the British need Stalin. They know that supplies won't be enough. They need manpower. The sacrifice of Russian troops by the millions will enable them to destroy the Nazi beast. In addition to American aid, Stalin wants to urgently open a second front, meaning an Allied landing in the West to divide German forces. Hitler is worried about the possibility of an Allied landing. He needs to finish off quickly in the East. He needs to put an end to Stalin. He needs to put an end to Stalingrad. The Stukas, the German dive bombers, complete the destruction of what once was the USSR's model city. General Paulus launches his 6th Army to attack Stalingrad. The Germans reach the ravines, the city's natural first line of defense. The Russians resist with great violence. Stalin declares, "If we surrender Stalingrad, the south of the country will be cut off from the center. We would lose our main waterway, and soon our oil, too." Stalin's rise to power began here, a quarter of a century earlier. This city, at the strategic intersection between Baku and Moscow, was known at the time as Tsaritsyn. 1918, the territory controlled by the Reds, Bolshevik communists, is attacked by the Whites, the Tsarist army. Civil war breaks out. Stalin already has a role in history's first communist government. At the head of this government is Lenin, who appreciates Stalin's determination. Stalin is commissar for food supplies. He travels to Tsaritsyn to find wheat for the country's hungry capital. Stalin steals all the grain reserves, sparking off rebellions and famines. Lenin has also put Stalin in charge of watching over the man who defends these rich agricultural lands. Trotsky, the powerful People's Commissar for War, has become too independent. Trotsky, in order to save the threatened city of Tsaritsyn, puts former officers from the Tsar's army in charge of his troops. These men are more competent leaders. Stalin defies Trotsky. He accuses Trotsky's officers of colluding with the Whites and decides to eliminate them. So he gathers them on barges and sinks the boats in the middle of the Volga. Stalin turns into a warlord, destroying villages, executing populations, and spreading terror. He makes awkward attempts to get involved in strategy, but Trotsky, just as violent but more skilled, sets things straight. This doesn't stop Stalin from proclaiming himself the conqueror of Tsaritsyn and donning this military dress, which he will wear from now on. He is present on every Civil War front. 1919. The Reds face new enemies. French, American, British, and Japanese have all come to support the Whites. But after the Great War and its massive death toll, Allied support remains limited. Their primary goal is to stop the spread of communism. Because Trotsky wants to export the revolution. He is counting on workers rising up across Europe. He attacks Poland, which has just acquired its independence. The Poles, with French support, resist the Reds' assault. Stalin, sent as backup, doesn't support Trotsky. 40,000 Bolshevik soldiers are captured. Despite his failure in Warsaw, Trotsky still embodies war communism, the Red Army's absolute priority. Trotsky succeeds in keeping Stalin away from military affairs, even though he is still in the government. People question Stalin's methods and wonder what is behind those small squinty eyes, even when he smiles. Helped by his Georgian accomplices, Stalin tames the separatists with his iron hand, just like he did in Baku, in Azerbaijan. The local communists are forced to celebrate the end of their independence to the tune of the Internationale, played on the tar, a popular Caucasian instrument. Stalin also reigns in Armenia and Georgia, his homeland. When he goes home to visit his mother, she asks, "Tell me, my son, you don't have the Tsar's blood on your hands, do you?" Stalin swears that he had no part in the assassination of Nicholas II and his family 3 years earlier. Nicholas II, captured by the Bolsheviks, along with his heir, the Tsarevich, the Empress, and their four daughters, were moved from location to location throughout the Civil War. They ended up in this house on the Siberian border, where they were executed. Who gave the order to shoot? Who really gives the orders in this regime? Is it Lenin, the regime's founder and supreme guide? Or the Council of the People's Commissars, the government that Stalin belongs to? Or the Political Bureau, the Politburo, that Stalin also belongs to? Orders are given by the Communist Party, where Stalin's power is rising. The party also inflates the power of the bureaucrats. To move ahead in this world, one must have a party card. In the words of Alexander Degtyarev, "Joining the ranks of the Communist Party was the greatest joy in my life. The party took care of our morale and our conscience. It gave me the strength to resist every ordeal. What kept me alive was my unwavering faith in our Leninist Party and our humanist principles." But what of humanist principles? The collective paranoia of Lenin, Stalin, and the Bolsheviks is so strong that they order a massive purge in the heart of the party. 220,000 members are thrown out. The secret police increases its efforts to hunt down the enemies of the people. The head executioner is Dzerzhinsky, along with his team of assassins. Stalin is a close, intimate friend. In his journal, Trotsky claims to have heard Stalin say to Dzerzhinsky, "The greatest delight is to pick out one's enemy, prepare all the details of the blow, to slake one's thirst for a cruel revenge, and then go home to bed." Here, next to Lenin, is Boris Bajanov, Stalin's personal secretary. He writes, during a Central Committee session, Trotsky said the following to Stalin's group. We will shoot you all. Yes, we will. You want to shoot us too, but you don't dare. But we will dare. Who will shoot whom? For Stalin, war had openly been declared by Trotsky when he wrote this to Lenin after the victory on the Volga. I consider the way Stalin took credit for the whole Tsaritsyn campaign to be akin to a dangerous wound. Stalin commissions a film, thus reinforcing his legendary status as a Civil War hero and conqueror of Tsaritsyn. He changes the city's name from Tsaritsyn to Stalingrad, or Stalin City. 20 years later, in 1942, Stalingrad is in ruins at the hands of the Germans. October 15, 1942, Hitler's troops, after 2 months of arduous combat, have reached their goal, the shores of the Volga. Across the river, the Russians regroup and are comforted by an unexpected declaration by Stalin. Tomorrow, we shall dance in the streets. What does Stalin mean? He knows that his military chief of staff, General Zhukov, is secretly preparing a counteroffensive. The fate of Stalin's country hangs in the balance, but Stalin also has some personal issues to contend with. He awaits a visit from Beria, the fearsome head of the secret police, along with the heads of the various law enforcement organizations. Stalin has asked for an investigation into a letter written by Roman Karman, a famous filmmaker. The letter denounces an affair between Karman's wife, a renowned actress named Nina Orlova, and Stalin's second son, Vasily, a fighter pilot in the 32nd Guards Air Regiment. Vasily is a dangerous pilot, and his father ultimately grounds him. He is drunk most of the time. He shoots the chandeliers and beats his wife, who just gave birth. Nicknamed the Tsarevich, Vasily organizes orgies. The letter also points a finger at Vasily's sister, 16-year-old Svetlana, Stalin's only daughter. The girl was found in the arms of Alexei Kepler, a renowned 38-year-old screenwriter. Stalin cannot imagine his daughter with a man 20 years her senior. But Stalin was 20 years older than Svetlana's mother, Nadezhda, who died in 1932, officially, of acute appendicitis. Svetlana had always been the favorite. She was fawned upon by seemingly inoffensive men, like the one she called Uncle Beria, the police chief. Or she would sit on the lap of the despot, a good family man, known to be facetious on occasion. In 1942, during the Battle of Stalingrad, Svetlana learns that her mother committed suicide 10 years earlier. Why? State secret. Svetlana consoles herself with Kepler. Through him, she discovers literature, often erotic in nature. Svetlana writes, what bothered my father most about Kepler was the fact that he was Jewish. During that month of November 1942, the letter denouncing Stalin's children is a very delicate business indeed. Its consequences directly affect the nomenklatura, the magic list of the regime's elite. From party officials to useful artists to police executioners. As long as they remain favorites, they can live in a state of comfort unknown to the rest of the Soviet population. This holds true even in the most dire periods of the war. So Alexei Kepler, Stalin's daughter's great love and a renowned figure in the film world, thought he was untouchable. He is sent to Stalingrad as a Pravda correspondent, ostensibly to be killed. He survives this hell, so Stalin has him deported to Siberia, beyond the Arctic Circle. He is taken to the Vorkuta concentration camp, otherwise known as the Ice Guillotine. Kapler is accused of having ties with foreign countries and of being an English spy. He is sentenced to 5 years in the Gulag. Gulag, an acronym for Main Camp Administration. The great Russian writer Solzhenitsyn refers to them as the Gulag Archipelago. Hundreds of concentration camps, often built during Lenin's day, whose numbers were infinitely increased by Stalin. While the world's fate is being decided at Stalingrad, at least 3 million Soviets have become Zeks. These unfortunate men are convicts, arrested by Stalin's police to fill his quotas and balance out the high mortality rate in the labor camps. This endless source of slave labor is an important contribution to the Soviet war economy. Gold is extracted from the Kolyma camp, and coal comes from Vorkuta. In this mining complex, university professors, violinists, and priests alike make their way down the shaft. Other Zeks build the railways across the endless stretches of snow. For Russians, hell isn't eternal fire. It's a desert of ice. Each guard is more barbaric than the next. They share the women, who are raped upon arrival. One Zek among others, Myron Etlis, explains further. The camp is a school of decomposition for all of us. Each man emerges with irreparable damages. Our people as a whole have been damaged by this collective experience. The Gulag has infected our genes. 1,607,000 Zeks die in the Gulags. Kapler, Svetlana's lover, survives by joining the Deportee Theater Company, a source of entertainment for the camp's administrators. This theater company is headed by a Zek, a former director of the Bolshoi, and various celebrities who fell out of Stalin's favor. Kapler spends 10 years in Vorkuta. Svetlana, Stalin's daughter, doesn't wait for his return. November 1942, entrenched in the paranoid solitude of the Kremlin, cut off from his family, Stalin ages. The Battle of Stalingrad occupies him 16 hours per day. He grabs a few hours sleep on a cot in his office. He chain smokes, and at 63 years old, his arteriosclerosis is life-threatening. November 19th, 1942. 13,000 Soviet cannons fire their terrifying multiple rocket launchers. The Germans nickname these missiles Stalin's organs after their roar. General Zhukov's Soviet armies have surrounded German General Paulus's 6th Army in the ruins of Stalingrad. Hitler orders Paulus not to break through the circle and retreat. 1 month later, the Germans are out of munitions and food. Cases of cannibalism abound. The Soviets are moving forward everywhere. February 2nd, 1943, filmmaker Roman Karman, who had alerted Stalin on his children's activities, is lucky enough to film this unique moment, the surrender of General Paulus. The head of German forces in Stalingrad was promoted to marshal the previous day by Hitler in a move to push Paulus to commit honorable suicide. But Paulus replies, "I'm not going to shoot myself for that corporal." Paulus doesn't see Hitler as the Führer anymore, but as the World War I soldier whose incompetence has led to disaster. Once Paulus finds himself a Soviet prisoner, he feels nothing but hatred towards Hitler. Hitler, on the other hand, wants to exchange him for Stalin's eldest son, Yakov, who is his prisoner since July 1941. Stalin prepares his answer. "I will not trade a marshal for a lieutenant." The body of Yakov, Stalin's son, is found in the electrical barbed wires of his prisoner camp in Germany. In Stalingrad, after 6 months of fighting, 500,000 Germans are dead. 100,000 have been captured. Very few will ever return home, even 10 years later. "900,000 Soviet soldiers have been killed. 700,000 have been wounded. In the eyes of the world, the great victor at Stalingrad is Stalin, who poses in his new uniform. The great martial star shines on his epaulets. The biggest American magazine of the time, Life, features Stalin on the cover of its March 29, 1943 issue, The Supreme Honor. This outcome couldn't have been predicted 20 years earlier. "1921. After 4 years of civil war, Russia counts millions of casualties, immigrants, and orphans. The country is ravaged by famine. Stalin is bothered by the sight of Trotsky still triumphant in Red Square. Even though war communism has brought about the fall of the economy. Severe rationing is in place, except for the 20,000 party and police officials, who are entitled to 4 kilos of meat and 4 kilos of fish per month. A worker only receives 200 grams of fish, usually rotten. The workers can no longer feed their families. They rise up, even though striking has been forbidden since December of 1917. Trotsky declares, all resistance can be countered by one word, shoot. At this point, 18,000 sailors and officers at Kronstadt, the naval base in the former capital of Petrograd, join the fray in support of the striking workers. Their credo is, yes to Soviets, no to Bolsheviks. Trotsky orders an assault on the Kronstadt sailors on March 7, 1921. 20,000 Red Army troops move across the frozen Baltic Sea. Behind them, to prevent them from turning back, members of the secret police are positioned with machine guns. After 10 days of bloody combat, the rebels have run out of food and munitions. They surrender to the Red Army soldiers. 2,168 sailors are executed and buried together. These very same men led the communists to victory in 1917. But the Kronstadt Rebellion forces Lenin to back down. He declares, "It is possible for us to take a few steps back without destroying the dictatorship of the proletariat." In March 1921, Lenin institutes the NEP, or New Economic Policy. This is a spectacular, albeit temporary, liberalization of the economy. Industry is denationalized, forced requisitions and required work is ended, inheritance is reinstated. Farmers are free to sell their harvest at will once again. Store shelves are filled up. Moscow dares to hope and celebrate again. The Bolsheviks need money. On March 19th, 1922, Lenin sends the following directive to the Politburo. We must pursue the removal of church property. We must smash the clergy most decisively and ruthlessly, and put down all resistance with such brutality that they will not forget it for several decades. Lenin concludes, violence is the truth of politics. Things are moving quickly at the Kremlin. The Bolshevik leaders are arriving in their Rolls Royces. On April 3rd, 1922, Stalin, nicknamed Lenin's best disciple, becomes Secretary General of the Communist Party. He is powerful, but always respectful towards Lenin. His future minister Molotov remarks, "People often ask me, who is tougher, Lenin or Stalin? Lenin, of course. He's the one who trained us all." Suddenly, on May 25th, 1922, Lenin suffers a stroke at the age of 52. He is partially paralyzed. 6 months later, he has a second stroke. The party's Central Committee puts Stalin in charge of taking care of him. Stalin isolates Lenin and prevents his entourage from writing anything dictated by him. The year closes with the creation on December 22, 1922, of the USSR, Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. Its emblem is the farmer's sickle and the proletarian worker's hammer. This grand announcement, along with the end of the Civil War, trigger hope for a respite. But the terror only intensifies. Secret police vans discharge truckloads of victims condemned from the start. 1923, the People's Commissar of Justice, Isaac Steinberg, escapes to Germany. He once asked Lenin, "What good is a Commissar of Justice? His title should be Commissar of Social Extermination." Lenin had replied, "Excellent idea." Steinberg writes, "Terror is a tight network of surveillance, a secret police that observes every deed and action, every provocation, using the most debasing, humiliating, and painful means of interrogation. Terror means prisons overcrowded with starving people. It means displaced populations, requisitions, and confiscations that strike out at the famished and the exhausted." Stalin carries Lenin's coffin. Nadezhda Krupskaya, his widow, reveals that Lenin managed to dictate a will in which he stated, "Stalin is too brutal. I suggest that the comrades find a way to remove him from his position as Secretary General." Stalin reacts very violently and threatens Lenin's widow, forcing her to publish a denial in Pravda. All the pallbearers, The most faithful Bolsheviks from the outset will try to use this will to get rid of Stalin. They will all die. Lenin's true will, respected to the letter by his heir Stalin, is his doctrine. The never-ending purification of the social body, which also applies to the party, the state, and the bureaucracy. The hunt for the false communist, that parasite who has infiltrated the party state's administrations. Eliminating these parasites, the survivors of a doomed capitalist society, is an essential task. This purge will be endless for Stalin as it was for Lenin. The war against the enemy will never be over. While Lenin's body is quickly being embalmed, Stalin blows up the frozen ground in front of the Kremlin wall to lay the foundations of a mausoleum. First comes the wood, followed by red granite and black marble, with a grandstand where the omnipotent communist leaders will ritually stand to dominate the people. But the people, like Trotsky, Stalin is still forced to applaud him. This is only the beginning of their underground duel to the death. Pioneers and Komsomols, the communist youth, march in front of the tomb all year long. Within their ranks, Vasily Nikolaev weeps. He wonders, how can the great Lenin be dead? It's impossible. He is a saint. Lenin's cult of personality is born. Stalin establishes a commission dedicated to the immortalization of the memory of Vladimir Ulyanov, known as Lenin. And Lenin's name is given to Petrograd, the former capital, St. Petersburg, which will now be called Leningrad. 1943. Germans have surrounded the city for the past 2 years. Hitler hasn't succeeded in conquering Stalingrad, the primary symbol of Soviet power, so he keeps going after the other symbol, Leningrad. Hitler declares, "I will destroy this city, decimate its population. It will never rise again. I hereby take this solemn oath." This proves to be one of the longest and most devastating sieges in history. 800,000 inhabitants die of hunger. 13-year-old Tanya Savicheva wrote a diary which has become a Russian national treasure. In 9 pages, Tanya sums up her ordeal. December 28th, Zhenya died. January 25th, Grandma died. March 17th, Leika died. April 13th, Uncle Vasya died. May 10th, Uncle Lisha died. May 13th, Mother died. The 10th page will never be written because Tanya has died of exhaustion. This encompasses all the suffering and resistance of the Soviet people. But are there any memories other than those of a country cursed? ...1925. Back then, the children of Moscow believe in the future. They cheer the heroes of the revolution gathered around Stalin, who marches towards power. These are the first Bolsheviks. Zinoviev, Kamenev, Voroshilov, the Civil War general, and Bukharin, who doesn't trust Stalin. He says, He is a schemer without principles whose thirst for power comes above all. He changes his theories even as he expresses them, depending on who he has chosen to eliminate. But they all stand beside Stalin in the fight against Trotsky, who continues to have the support of many militants. Stalin, in the hope of dispensing with debates and contestation, distributes party membership to proletarians and descendants of proletarians. These people have no education or training in politics, but they will always be grateful to Stalin for allowing them to rise within the bureaucracy. Trotsky begins to be booed, and little by little cast aside. Stalin doesn't yet have the power to kill off his enemies. But after 3 years of fierce struggle and devious plotting, he manages to get Trotsky banned from the party. Stalin can now humiliate Trotsky and have him exiled to a faraway Soviet republic in Central Asia. Stalin has him filmed, escorted by police officers whose chief, on the right, with the gun in his pocket, directs the camera. Next, Stalin gets the Politburo to accuse this founding member of the USSR of anti-Soviet activities. Trotsky is deported. December 21st, 1929, Stalin is 50. He is now the absolute ruler of the Soviet Union. He summons the cameras to the Kremlin in front of a statue of Lenin to show that he is truly the heir. With his henchmen, who are blindly devoted in exchange for their lives, Stalin can finally rid himself of the NEP, the attempt at liberalization, and fully engage in collectivization. The party newspaper, the Pravda, is displayed in the hallways of the Kremlin, boasting this front-page headline: "A great Bolshevik round of applause for the greatest communist leader in the world." 20 years later, he will really be one of the most powerful men in the world. November 25th, 1943, Stalin takes an airplane for the first time in his life. Flying over his native Caucasus, he is afraid. He's traveling to Tehran to attend a conference of allies against Germany. With his newfound power, Stalin was able to impose his embassy in Iran as the meeting location. The embassy is secured by a battalion of Soviet policemen and full of hidden microphones. The sight of Stalin is a surprise to the attendees. He limps, and his atrophied arm adds to his bear-like demeanor. Churchill, in his Royal Air Force attire, strikes a pose. The conference's opening ceremony begins with the Internationale, still the Soviet anthem, for now. Stalin, who orchestrated everything on his own, is surrounded by his old accomplices, Marshal Voroshilov, and Molotov, his Minister of Foreign Affairs. On behalf of King George VI, Churchill gives Stalin a sword with the following inscription: "To the steel-hearted citizens of Stalingrad." Voroshilov has the misfortune of dropping the sword. He throws a distraught glance at Stalin. He knows he is about to be insulted in public. Until a policeman relieves him of his burden. Then Churchill and Stalin join the American president, Franklin Roosevelt, who is disabled and tired from the long trip to Tehran. Stalin wants to get closer to Roosevelt, who he believes to be naive and easily manipulated. Stalin needs support against Churchill on the issue of a second front. Churchill wants to attack from the south, the soft underbelly of Europe, outrun the Russians and arrive first in Berlin. But Stalin wins out with the Normandy invasion, further away, planned for the spring of 1944. Roosevelt shows his consideration for Stalin in this official photo. Everyone hopes to be introduced to Stalin, even Sarah, Churchill's daughter. Optimism is in the air. Stalin just defeated Hitler in the Battle of Kursk. Churchill declares, "God is on the Allies' side." Stalin replies, "The devil is on my side. He's a good communist." Is Stalin on his way to becoming master of the world?
Ласковую мать.